Hello everybody, welcome back. I'm Ian Laspina, and in the last video we discussed gauntlets. In today's video we will be beginning our discussion of helmets. And today we will be focusing on the Great Helm. So before we get started, I just want to explain how we're going to be approaching helmets. So helmets is a huge topic. There are so many different styles of helmets, and then variations within each of those styles of helmets, and then more obscure helmet styles and things like that that appear throughout the course of the Middle Ages, that there's no way we can possibly address everything. So we're going to kind of restrict our focus and break it into more manageable chunks. So that's why today we'll be focusing specifically on the Great Helm. Okay, so beginning with our normal historical survey, we'll back up to about Hastings' era like we usually do. And what we see around this time is kind of the ubiquitous nasal helm. So at Hastings, the nasal helm takes the form of a conical-shaped helm with a nasal, which is an additional piece of metal that's attached to the rim of the helmet that extends down over the nose to protect the nose and face. We see variations on the conical-style helmet. Sometimes the point is centered, like in the Bayeux tapestry. Sometimes the point is swept forward, like you see here in this example. And in this late 12th century example here, we still see the nasal helm, but instead of a cone, it's just a hemispherical, more low-profile style helmet, but still retains that nasal to protect the nose and face. Through the 12th century, we also see the nasal helm being worn virtually all the time with a male coif. Sometimes it appears like the male coif is worn over the helmet, sometimes it looks like it's worn under the helmet, but they're usually worn in conjunction with each other. Around the end of the 12th century, what we start to see, though, is the development of the faceplate. So instead of just relying on that nasal to protect the nose and face, we're starting to see a more robust means of defense in the faceplate development. Moving into the early parts of the 13th century, that faceplate starts to get more refined. It starts to cover more and more of the face. And we also start to see the back of the helmet extending downward to cover more of the back of the head. By the middle parts of the 13th century, we now see what would basically be the earliest form of a great helm. It's now a fully enclosing helmet that encases the entire head in plate. And this is the general style that you see, that you think of when you think of that high Middle Ages knight, like the images that you see here in the Mac Bible. Now there's a lot of variations on this style, different subtle shapings, but they all have that basic flat top, fully encased great helm design, riveted construction, most likely of individual plates riveted together. By the later parts of the 13th century, now we start to see experimentation with more rounded and more glancing surfaces, especially on the top of the helm. You can imagine with the flat top style helm, any weapon that hits directly on top of it, that force is going to be driven straight down and ultimately right into your spine, which, you know, that can cause some serious injury on an object that's primary purpose is to protect you and prevent you from getting killed. So we start to see that what would eventually become the sugarloaf helm starts its development around this time. The flat top style great helm and that more rounded style great helm will kind of coexist into the beginning of the 14th century, but eventually the flat top style helm will disappear and the great helm will retain that more rounded, more hemispherical or conical shape in order to encourage weapons to glance away from the surfaces. It's also around the same time that we start to see hints of the fact that the great helm is no longer being worn as the sole helmet, but it's being worn in addition to a smaller secondary helm. The smaller secondary helmet is often referred to as a cervelier, or a secret helm, or just a skull cap, but it's basically a very low profile, hemispherically shaped helmet, worn in addition to the male coif, and then the great helm is worn over top of that. What this would eventually do is evolve into the bassinet, the early bassinet, where now the male was integrated directly with the helm via an aventail instead of a discrete male coif, and then the great helm worn in addition to that. Bassinets are going to have their own video, but it's impossible to talk about the evolution of the great helm without talking about the bassinet, because the two drive each other. So you see, as the bassinet develops into a more robust head defense, so too does the great helm evolve to be able to work in conjunction with that bassinet. So moving into the middle parts of the 14th century, what we see is that the bassinet is really kind of coming into its own as a more substantial head defense, but the great helm is still being worn. So in order to accommodate the changes in styling of the bassinet, the great helm is becoming a pretty large helm at this point. And this is when you get into the mid to late 14th century Pembridge style great helm. It's a pretty large helm, very broad profile, and hemispherical top to encourage glancing individual plates riveted together to form that large kind of very intimidating profile. And then that is worn suspended over the great helm. Moving into the very late parts of the 14th century, what we start to see is that lower plate that forms the part that protects the lower part of the head and ultimately terminates at the lower part of the sights starts to protrude forward. As it protrudes forward, we see styles like the helm here attributed to Henry V, and you can see how that lower plate kind of protrudes out. So this would develop into the early frogmouth helm, which is almost always depicted as an equestrian type helmet. It wouldn't really be very useful for foot combat because it's so massive, but you can see all of the compound curves and glancing surfaces on that are perfectly designed to encourage things like spears and lances from deflecting away from the head on horseback during cavalry charge or a joust or something like that. Eventually, it would really find its home on the joust field in the fully developed form of this helmet, like you see here. This one dates to 1500 and is kind of the ultimate evolution of that frogmouth style helm. And you can even see the holes down on the chest portion of it that actually bolt to the breastplate to make it even more safe so that the helmet can't be jarred to the side when it's struck with a lance during the joust. Alright, so now we're going to take a look at this specific example. So this example here, it does not belong to me. I wish it did. It's a beautiful helmet. This one was made by Robert MacPherson for a friend of mine, and he was kind enough to loan it to me for the filming of this video so that you guys could see it, because I do not own a great helm. So thank you very much to him for allowing me to use this helmet for the video. This helmet is constructed very similarly to the helm that is associated with the Black Prince and the funerary achievements of the Black Prince. So it's that same Pembridge-style late 14th century helm, and you can see the way it's constructed. It is individual plates riveted together, and then that hemispherical top that encourages weapons to glance away from the helmet itself. The sights are very narrow for prevention of weapon penetration, and then you have breaths on this particular one on either side of the helm. And you'll also notice that there are two punched out cross-shaped holes here on the bottom of the helm. What we see is that during the middle parts of the 14th century, because now the great helm is being worn with the bassinet, sometimes you don't always want to have the great helm on. The open face bassinet is, you can see everything, you can breathe uninhibited. Wearing this all the time, you can imagine you're not going to be able to see nearly as much, you're not going to be able to breathe as much, so you don't want to have it on all the time. What we see is that a lot, remember back to the breastplate video, we saw some of those globose coats of plates that had retention chains and things on them. The way, and we also see evidence for straps being used to suspend the great helm. And the way that that works is one of those chains feeds up to the great helm, and you insert basically a pin into this. And once it's inside, you orient it in a way that it has trouble pulling back out. And you can actually take the great helm off, sling it over your shoulder, and wear it on your back when you don't need it. But when you do need it, it's immediately available to take and put back over top of the bassinet that you're wearing. So that's why you'll typically see these holes here. So this great helm is being worn, it's designed to be worn in conjunction with an open face bassinet. So I'm gonna go ahead and lift this off. So bassinets will get their own video, so we're not gonna focus on it too much, but what's important to see is that a bassinet specifically designed for wear with a great helm, like this one, is a very low profile bassinet. It doesn't have a high peak or anything like that. And that makes it more conducive to wear with the great helm. If you can imagine with a more, a bassinet, a hound skull bassinet designed specifically to be worn as a standalone helmet with a very pronounced peak, that's not going to lend itself as well to being worn in conjunction with a great helm. So this bassinet has no associated visor. You can see that there's no pivots or no hinge for a clap visor or anything like that. It's just an open face bassinet with its own aventail. And then the way that the great helm interacts with it is you can see here on the, hopefully you can see that on the inside of the great helm, you have a leather suspension system that is designed to sit atop the bassinet and allow the great helm to float in the right spot so that you get the proper orientation of the great helm over your face. All right, so at this point, I'm going to put the combination of the helmets on so that you can see what they look like on an actual person. And I'll show you movement and things like that. So first we'll put the bassinet on. Okay, so just wearing the bassinet, you can see I have unrestricted vision, I have unrestricted ability to breathe. I can move my head side to side like normal. So you can see why this would be advantageous to have this option instead of having to wear the great helm all the time. So this is why you could remove it, sling it over your shoulder if needed, and then put it on at a later point when you do require that additional protection. So now I'm going to put the great helm on. I'll demonstrate movement side to side. Since you can't really see what's happening inside the great helm as I wear it, you can visualize what's happening by looking at this sketch by the armor. So Robert MacPherson drew this sketch, and he was very kind to grant me permission to use it so that I could show you guys what it looks like when the great helm is oriented properly to make sure that the sights align with the eyes. And that is achieved through that internal suspension system inside the great helm and its proper interaction with the bassinet. Okay, so what I hope you noticed is that I still actually had the same range of motion with the neck as I did with just the bassinet on. The only change in movement was the addition of the weight kind of weighing down on your head, but the actual range of motion of the neck is really unaffected. And a lot of that has to do with the proper suspension of the great helm. So the great helm is suspended, it's floating on top of the bassinet, it's not sitting on your shoulders. If you can imagine, if it was sitting on your shoulders, it would start to restrict that motion, and it would actually become a liability, because if you're struck in the helmet with it resting directly on the shoulders, it's going to drive that force through the edges of that helm right into your collarbones or into your shoulders and cause injury. So that suspension system is very important. All right, everybody. I hope you really enjoyed that look at the Great Helm. As always, if you like the video, please give me a thumbs up, subscribe if you haven't already. Feel free to follow me on Facebook. The link is in the description. Share the video, and thank you very much. Appreciate it. We'll be back soon with more of helmet videos. Obviously, I'm never going to need to waste a lot of breath paper and write about my natural battle for my belly. But first thing, what it does show is being pointed, as I squat down or lean forward, my lower torso like falls collapse, that translates into a half like a proper grip of the sweater or wrap on the top of the shoulder, while still finding protection of steel on the finger.
You'll also note that the upper edge of the breast plate getting out of it on top of the lower extremity.
Strapping the arms, everybody who